like it. My name is Jerker Olofsson. I'm Vice President Global Sales Development at Atlas Copco. I'm really excited to be here. I'm, of course, delighted to speak about my favorite topics of the world. I'm going to speak about customer interaction, sales development, and digital marketing. But before I get started, I'm going to ask you a question. Do you like your job? Yes. Hands up, everyone that likes your job. Hands up, everyone that loves your job. Hands up, everyone that thinks you have the best job in your company. All right, but that's great. We have a great team here. You love your job. Most of you think you have the best job in your company, and I think I have the best job in Atlas Copco. We're close to 40,000 people, and I always say I have the best job in Atlas Copco. And I keep on telling that to everyone that wants to listen and also those that do not want to listen. And I'm saying that to our CEO as well. Whenever I meet him, and I actually met him early this week, so I said, Mats, I think I have the best job in Atlas Copco. And what do you think he said? He said, like, shoot, I thought I had that position, but please enlighten me. So I really love what I'm doing because of a couple of reasons. I think one, it's really fun because it's changing. The way we interact with customers changes every day. It's challenging, it's disruptive, it's digital. I think it's relevant because it's equally relevant for all commercial divisions, the way we interact with customers. And I think it's important because the buying experience is the single biggest contributor to customer loyalty. And that is what I'm intending to speak to you about today. And I'm, of course, delighted when Emma reached out a couple of weeks ago and said, hey, you know, are you willing to come and share your experience in our event? And I was like, absolutely. And I looked back at what we had done. And even if this is the theme of the presentation, digitalizing a global sales force, I didn't find a story about digitalizing a global sales force. I actually found a story about driving change in a quite successful, extremely decentralized, product-oriented industrial company. And I think that's a story maybe more worthwhile telling, and that's what I'm gonna share with you today. Does that make sense? All right, good. So this story starts back in 2014, and it doesn't even start with digitalization. It actually starts with sales development. I just came back from Southeast Asia, where I've been the general manager, and I saw this huge opportunity within Atlas Copco to really develop a best way of doing sales. And not only for Sweden, but actually scale it all over the world to all the custom centers. And I felt that that would be really amazing to do. But to get there, I needed to convince Atlas Copco that this was a great idea. So, of course, I started with the presidents. And, you know, selling stuff internally is almost always harder than selling it externally. So I started with the presidents, and I was thinking about what is the common denominator for all the commercial divisions? What do these guys really want? What can we agree on? And we could all agree on profitable growth is a great thing. No one could actually argue that. That is what we all want. So we start with that, and then we looked at what is really contributing to profit. And one of the single biggest contributors is customer loyalty. Only a small increase in customer loyalty will have a huge impact on the lifetime profit. So far, so good. Then we took the next step and we said, okay, what is really contributing to loyalty? And we could show that the buying experience is the single biggest driver for customer loyalty. And can you imagine speaking about this in Atlas Copco, where we are extremely product-oriented? We love our products. We are so excited about the products. But when we could show this, it actually changed the mind of many people. And this was actually the birth of our, what we ended up calling strategic partnership selling, a global framework for doing sales, with a positioning statement creating a superior customer experience. And when we did this, I thought this was kind of a cool tagline. But afterwards, I realized how instrumental this became for everything we needed to do. Because if we can identify the factors that drives a superior buying experience, then we have a great foundation for everything else, not only in-person selling, but also digital marketing, virtual selling. So this was really the first piece. And we did that. So we looked at what factors is actually driving a superior buying experience. And we said, if we can teach the customer something truly unique about how they can become better that they obviously didn't know before, that's a great start. If we can tailor this message so it becomes relevant for the customer, not only teaching them something unique, but actually tailoring it so it's relevant for the business drivers, that's the next step. The third step is take control of the discussion with overwhelming justification to take action. These would be the factors that drives a superior buying experience, and it makes it more easy for the customer to buy. And then we should remember Atlas Copco. Hands up everyone that have heard about Atlas Copco before. Hands up everyone that actually knows what we're doing. All right, this is great, a couple of you. We're doing many, many different things. We're purely business to business, and the business area I work for, we're doing assembly systems. So if you were coming here by a car, it was assembled by the Atlas Copco stuff. If you have a smartphone, it's assembled with Atlas Copco. So we do assembly equipment. But this was really the start of creating this superior buying experience. Yep. So we started to develop, and we looked at the customer journey. We looked at the sales process linked to the steps the customer has to go through to buy something from Atlas Copco. We looked at action steps. We looked at support tools for the salespeople, so we could actually scale this global and have all Atlas Copco salespeople actually live this way of selling. And when we had that in place, we had the strategy, and it was all about implementation. And we were implementing like hell. And you know, scaling this globally, this was back when we could travel. So you were literally traveling everywhere. And it was rolled out in China, in Germany, in the US. And it actually ended up being the single biggest learning initiative in the history of the business. We trained close to, this is even old stats, we trained 1,700 salespeople in this way of doing sales. The challenge with this was, of course, we met hundreds and hundreds of salespeople, but I didn't hear a story about selling. I ended up hearing another story, and it was a story about buying. It was not about selling, it was a buying. It was a story about these growing buying teams, these dysfunctional buying teams, how hard it is for the buying teams to reach consensus. It was a story about the customers making a big chunk of the decision before meeting our salespeople. It was a story about customers reaching out to our webpage equally often as our sales reps. It was a story about being digital, not only in the beginning of the buying journey, but throughout the complete buying journey. And at the end, it was also a story about it was not only the young and savvy people that did this. It was all generations. And then we looked into how are the customers actually spending their time in the buying journey, and what are they doing? And we realized that, shoot, the biggest chunk of time is spent on research independently online. And this is web and social networks. And only 17% was meeting the supplier. And you know, we were not the only supplier. We were probably one out of three. And that ends up, we had 6% of the time in front of the customer. And 27% were spent on digital. And if you're in sales, you go like, this is no good. You know, we got to fix this. But you can't fix it. I mean, we're not the makers here. We are the takers. This is a train that is leaving, and we need to be on it. And we realized that, shoot, we need to do something. So it was time for a new change project. And it was really about aligning. We already have the in-person sales process in place, but it was also to align the digital selling process or the digital marketing process. So again, we needed to reach out, or I needed to reach out to the president. It was a new change project. We wanted to not only obviously do it in Sweden, but do it everywhere, all across the globe. And this is where I got in touch with Davos, and this is where I met you, Emma, I think, first time. So what do? Selling things internally is the same thing as selling externally in terms of the way you do it. So we needed to teach the president something new that they didn't know. We needed to tailor the message so it became relevant, and we needed to take control with overwhelming justification. So we got them in a room. We did a President Digital Discovery Day. And we were going through the ins and outsides of digital interaction and digital marketing with the objective of selling a pilot. And we actually walked out of selling a pilot. We got an agreement. And I remember at the very end of the meeting, one of the presidents said, "Hey, Jerker, I'm not really sure I understand all the details here, but this truly it makes a lot of sense. So let's try it." So we did. We started in the US. And here it says marketing automation pilot, but it was more than marketing automation. It was the full-blown Rian's model with use cases, with case stories, with lead scoring, with all that stuff. And it ended up not only being US, we actually expanded it to more countries. And it turned out to be pretty okay. And everything that is kind of hidden is not so important. But what was important was all the stuff we created, in approximately 50% of the cases, it led to an opportunity to sell. So we could hand over stuff to sales, and in 50% of the opportunities, they had a chance to sell. And they loved it. I mean, they really loved it. And we heard stories about breaking into accounts that had been brick-walled for years. We had Dan Tynes, our digital marketing manager in the US, he really said, we are the heroes. We're able to help sales break into places where they've never been before. So this was all great, I think. But then it was time to scale. That was only the pilot. So then we were about to scale this globally. And then we needed to try to define what does best practice look like. So we are, and again, we're Atlas Copco. We like to we're engineers. We like to express things in steps. That feels extremely comfortable for us. Steps, stairs, whatever. So we use the same type of visualization. So of course we created four steps to digital leadership in marketing. We agreed we need to be best in class on traffic generation. We need to have a really engaging content hub. We need to have some kind of nurturing conversion. And we need, ideally, to have configuration and order placement at the end. And this was extremely instrumental for us as well, because we needed to point out the direction. This is what we like to achieve. And we started to work on it. So we put together a team for traffic generation with, you know, resources, systems, and training, extremely important when you want to scale globally. We had the content hub, same thing, same winning formula, resource system, training. We had the nurturing and conversion. And you remember, we started with one program. Now I think we have like 8 to 12 global programs that are on all the time, generating business for us. And the last step was this configuration and order placement. And here I think we did are doing the biggest investments. We're putting together a complete team for digital platforms, trying to tie all this together. And that means a new e-commerce engine, the product finder, and all those great things. So things were really happening, and we got traction. And again, we were hearing all these great stories. We're generating stuff, and that is being followed up by sales, and we're generating business. But then things were changing again. And what happened then? Corona! Absolutely. This happened. And shoot, things were changing again. So we ended up in this situation. You remember this. We kind of felt that we nailed and scaled that part. But then we had this meeting with suppliers that turned into be only virtual interactions. And oh my gosh, we realized we were not great at this. And we also realized another thing. This is not going to go back to normal. So we have been looking into this, and 80% of our customers are saying that the virtual interaction will remain on current level or increase also post-COVID-19. So this is something we need to deal with. And why will it not go back? Well, the same customer is saying, 70% is saying that the virtual interaction is actually as effective or even more effective than the in-person. So if that's more effective, why would you ever want to go back to in-person meetings? And here we have a Salesforce that is used to meeting with the customers, you know, walking the line, diagnosing unknown issues, and shoot, now we can't even see the customers anymore. So we realized that it's time to change. And we tried to, so it was time for a new change project here. And we looked at what does it take to be successful in this new world of virtual interaction? Well, one piece is, our sales teams need to master virtual selling. The other piece is that they need to master modern digital sales tools. So we created a new project, and we had the whole framework for selling things in person called strategic partnership selling. Well, now we turn that into a virtual program. And will it be easy? Probably not. It requires a huge change in the way we do things. Will it be worth it? We certainly believe so. But the challenge here is that we also looked at what would this mean for the Salesforce, potentially mean for the Salesforce. And this indicates that if we would go primarily to a virtual selling model, 25% of the salespeople would be excited. 55% will be demotivated or quit. I mean, we can't have that. We can't have 50% of our salespeople quitting. So this was time to do things differently. And we couldn't just do it the same way as we'd done before. And we needed to really create a behavioral change. So we turned to research here, and we realized that this Dr. Brinkerhoff has a lot of really good theories on learning journeys, where he did this study on this group one that had a kind of a traditional approach to learning with a lot of emphasis on this, you know, face-to-face training, not so much preparation, not so much follow-up. They achieved a 15% change in behavior. And that was totally not enough. Then they have the other group where they introduced learning journeys, where they put in a lot of efforts before the training, quite much during, but much on the follow-up. And they created these learning journeys with learning events spread out over time with clear objectives and clear follow-up. And we were like, oh my gosh, this is something for us. This is something we need to embrace now. So we did. We created a learning journey for the virtual selling program. It's kind of hard to keep track of this if you don't have a system. And we got into this promote system. So we built this learning journey in promote system. We started a pilot. We have 60 participants from all over the world, from US, from India, from Brazil, from Italy, from Germany, in this pilot. And we're setting up tasks for each and one of these individuals over a period of now 2 months. And for me, this is great because I love deadlines. And for me, this gives me a deadline and for me to complete the task and make me move forward in the learning journey. And it's kind of interesting because you see on the graphics here, you have the top learner all the way to the right, and you have where I am, and you have the average. So it's kind of a competition in the team as well. And of course, the US team want to beat the German, and the Germans want to beat the Indians. And no one is ever beating the Indians, by the way, so that's give up. So we're putting this in place. And we're building it off of different blocks. And it's not only the modern digital sales tools, if you will, but we're getting in with LinkedIn, I think one of the best social networks for business to business. And we're getting into the Sales Navigator. And two out of the 5 blocks is around how to use Sales Navigator to build stakeholders and engage with customers. But the other ones is only on virtual selling. You know, how do you perform an effective virtual meeting? How do you make sure that you can do a great virtual presentation, a great virtual configuration? How can you be a challenger in a virtual environment without coming across that's really arrogant? So these are the things that we're putting into place now to make ourselves more comfortable doing this with the customer. But since we have 60 people in the room, and this is also 60 people in the group, and we're all learning for the first time. We're adding this thing with the tips of the week. So all of these people, they need to provide one tip every week on stuff that is working for them, sharing it with everyone else. And of course, this is great. And these tips, it's kind of high and low. You know, some are great, some are... And I'm in here as well. So this is my tip the second week. And it's maybe not the most profound tip in the history of tips, but it was, you know, when you're going to do a presentation, make sure you stand up, make sure you have your PC in eyesight, make sure, because you deliver in a completely different way. Make sure you have a post-it note on the floor so you don't walk out of the picture, etc., etc. But it's great, creating a great learning community with this team, and we're learning really fast. The other things we're doing now is putting in the success stories. And the success stories is when we get traction with customers, when we're landing orders or we get with new stakeholders. And we're really sharing this within the learning team. And this is also my way to make this team the stars. This team need to be the stars because, of course, I want to scale this globally afterwards. So we're doing that as well. Does it work? Absolutely. We see kind of, well, good results, lots of leads generated only through this initiative. We have great cases where we're landing big orders only because of this initiative. This was actually a case in Middle East where one of the participants reached out to the CEO of one of the biggest oil and gas companies in Middle East. And do you think, are these small or big companies? They're like huge. I mean, they're like enormous. This guy, he realized, he went to the same school as the CEO. He reached out to the CEO and got connected. Now when this guy is trying to arrange a meeting in that company with someone, what do you think they think when he reaches out? Of course, they were looking him up. He will realize he's connected with the CEO and they went to the same university. Of course, they're university buddies, they think. And do you think anyone dares to deny him a meeting? No one! So we have these stories, and it's also stories about brick wall, getting into accounts that has been brick walled for years. So lastly here with the recommendation we got when we looked into this was this virtual selling. Use the moment right now to go all in on this because the customers are ready. This is the timing. And now we're scaling this across the globe, putting together the program, starting in different parts of the world. And I truly believe that this might be this initiative might be on top of this way we do sales, the digital marketing. This might be this little red balloon that will extend the lead versus competition. Good. So what did we speak about? We talked about sales development. We talked about digital marketing. We talked about virtual selling. Some of my learnings from this journey was first, define the factors that drives a superior buying experience. Foundation for everything. When you have that, we can scale it to any kind of channel. Next one, it's really hard to sell stuff when you don't have a baseline, because in, at least in Atlas Copco, the first question we will get is, what's going to be the ROI on this? But use external research for justifying the initiative. Work with external, we're working with Avast that are helping us with this, but we work with others as well. Split up your initiative in manageable pieces with clear wins. Otherwise, it's just going to be too big to launch. Focus on getting the pilot started. And since I'm working since this is going to be deployed, not only obvious in Sweden, but everywhere, I need to work with internal resources. And for me, it's really been working to find the most talented people that has great credibility in Atlas Copco, because this is going to help me scale it further. Last but not least, implement like hell. Go all in, really put everything in there, and treat it as if it was a matter of life and death. Thank you very much.